Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Does God Really Like Me? Discovering the God Who Wants to Be With Us by Cyd Holsclaw and Geoff Holsclaw. Narrated by Susan Hanfield and Jim Denison. Introduction. I don't know what I did wrong, but he had that calmer-than-calm look that hid a rage inside. I picked up the phone and saw her name. Not now. I can't handle her right now. I scanned the room, looking for someone I knew. I just wanted to disappear. I didn't have the energy for small talk. So I got more appetizers. "How dare you!" he screamed. Then he let loose about everything that's wrong with me. If I said anything, she would just blow up again. So I let it go. We've all experienced situations like these. We've felt disconnected and judged, overwhelmed by friends, and underwhelmed by our relatives. We know how it feels when someone doesn't want us around, and we know how it feels when someone is sucking up all our energy. We've been yelled at, and we've yelled back. We've been ignored, we've done the ignoring. We felt people were just putting up with us, and we've just put up with others, too. Whether we know it or not, all these experiences color our experience of God. If you've been ignored, scolded, or shamed, then you've probably wondered, consciously or unconsciously, if God is ignoring, scolding, or shaming you. Or more painfully, maybe you think God is just putting up with you. We're told that God loves us, but the real question is, does God really like me? God has to... Parents sometimes say that while they certainly love their children, they don't always like them. We get it. We both love our children with a fierce and uncompromising love. We would never abandon them or hurt them, but there have been times when it's hard to like them. Sometimes it's because of what is going on with us, and sometimes it's what's going on with them. Sometimes the best we can do is just tolerate our loved ones until it gets better, putting up with them because we have to. And we've all been on the receiving end of this experience, too. A parent or some other loved one tells us they love us when they clearly don't like us very much at that moment, and maybe they would rather not be with us either. We get the real message loud and clear. After enough of these experiences, it's easy to believe God feels the same way about us. God promises to love us, but we actually come to believe that God is just putting up with us, tolerating us because he has to, not because he wants to. God has to love me, we think, but God doesn't like me. But what if God really does like you? What if God is always glad to be with you? What if God is filled with joy because of you? What if God is always moving toward you and not just keeping his distance? What if God likes you so much that he truly enjoys being with you? What if God appreciates you so much that he wants to partner with you to accomplish all his purposes in the world? You might be skeptical. Maybe you think all this sounds cheesy or naive. Maybe it's even offensive or disgraceful to think the God of the universe likes you and wants to be with you. Maybe it doesn't line up with your understanding of God's sovereignty or majesty. Maybe it makes God sound pathetic or needy or all too human. But here's the thing. We've become convinced, through studying the Bible, through meeting God personally in prayer, and through living with God in community with others, that it's all true. We're convinced that everything changes when we believe God is glad to be with us. It changes how we experience God's presence. It changes how we live. It will change your life. When we trust that God wants to be with us, We learn to live as if we belong with God, as if we're really wanted by God. When we trust that God is giving purpose to our lives, we can freely offer our lives as a blessing to others. An appetizer. Here is a small taste of what it means that God longs to be with us and to work through us. It's a little appetizer before the main course in the chapters ahead. It comes from the Gospel of Matthew. The Gospel of Matthew is bookended by two stories. The first is the angel's visit to Joseph. After finding out that his bride-to-be was already pregnant, Joseph planned to break off his engagement with Mary. But an angel intervenes to reassure Joseph that Mary's pregnancy is all part of God's plan. Then, like a narrative voiceover in a movie, Matthew explains to his readers that Mary's pregnancy is a fulfillment of Isaiah's prophecy that a virgin would bear a son whose name would be Emmanuel. And, just so we don't miss it, Matthew tells us what that name means. God is with us. Matthew chapter 1, verses 21 through 23. This might seem like an insignificant detail at the beginning of the book, but let's go to the end of Matthew's Gospel. The last chapter ends with what is often called the Great Commission. Jesus sends his followers to all nations to make disciples, baptizing and teaching them all the ways of Jesus. But notice the last thing Jesus says to his disciples. Wherever his disciples go, whatever they might face, Jesus tells them, "Remember, I am with you always." Matthew chapter 28, verse 20. "I am with you always." These are the last words in Matthew's Gospel. It's no coincidence that Matthew begins by describing the birth of Jesus as Emmanuel, God with us, and ends with Jesus announcing, "I am with you always." Matthew is making crystal clear that the main course in the meal of salvation is God with us. And God with us is not just something that happened in the past. It's a continual and permanent promise reaching into the present moment of our lives. God promises to be with us. Always. No matter what. In fact, we're going to see that God dwelling with us is the main point of the entire biblical story, not just from the beginning to the end of Matthew's Gospel, but from the beginning in Genesis to the end in Revelation. God longs to dwell with humanity, and only from this place of God with us is God also working through us. But this is just an appetizer, and you can't live off appetizers. We need a full meal. To get this full meal, to receive God's daily bread, we need to know and experience God differently, and we need to read and understand the Bible differently. When the biblical meal falls short. Have you ever walked into your local grocery store and found that everything has been moved? You go to the produce section only to find bulk nuts and seeds. You go to the cereal aisle and find paper goods instead. It might take twice as long to get everything on your list because nothing is where it used to be. It's all the same stuff, but it's not where you expect to find it. We think eggs belong in the dairy section because that's where they have always been. But eggs really have nothing to do with cows or milk. Eggs and milk are both good things, but they don't both come from cows. Putting them in the same section in the grocery store has confused people about the dairy status of eggs. The same thing can happen when we read the Bible. We come to the Bible expecting to find what we've always found. We can easily think parts of the Bible are focused on one thing and entirely miss what they are really talking about. To see how we can miss the emphasis on joy in God's presence and purposes, let's turn to a verse you might be familiar with, Romans chapter 3, verse 23. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. We might say this verse is made up of three key ingredients: sin, fall short, and the glory of God. One common way to mix these ingredients is to think of sin as missing the mark or target. Fall short is taken as to fail. These two words mixed together create something like failing to hit the mark. The glory of God is then understood to mean God's righteous law or moral perfection, which obviously we have failed to live up to. So the recipe for these three ingredients looks like this. One part, missing the mark, sin. One part, to fail, fall short. One part, God's moral perfection, the glory of God. This cooks up a meal of, we have all missed the target, failing God's moral perfection. The implication is clear. We are condemned by God for failing to live up to the good and righteous standard He put in place. This meal can leave a bitter taste in our mouths. It's easy to get the sense that God is angry or disappointed with us. Of course, we try to remember that God is love. But after reading this verse, God's love often feels like an afterthought. It feels almost apologetic. Sorry the meal tastes so horrible. Here's a little ice cream of love to wash it down. When we read Romans chapter 3, verse 23, according to this recipe, it's hard to comprehend that God loves being with us. Instead, it feels like God is all too ready to punish us for failing His standard and merely tolerates us because He has to. Love doesn't seem to be the essence of God. It seems like an afterthought. Cooking the recipe of Romans chapter 3, verse 23, and the entire Bible this way makes for a bitter meal, choked down out of obedience rather than delight. We are hungry and need to eat, and this is the only meal before us. Is there another way to serve up this verse? Another way to understand the Bible? Another way to experience God? Lost the presence and purposes of God. Let's look at these three ingredients again, but in reverse order. The glory of God, properly understood through the Old Testament, most often refers to the overwhelming display of God's presence. When Scripture speaks of God's glory, the primary meaning is the location of God's presence. Where God's glory is, there God is. In this specific context, the glory of God is probably the presence of God experienced by Adam and Eve that was then lost in the fall, coupled with the glory that God gave humanity by making them in His image. The second ingredient is fall short. A better understanding of this word is to be lacking or in want of, rather than merely to fail. John Murray explains that this word refers more to a condition of being, something I am, than an action, something I've done. Mixing these two ingredients creates the meaning of lacking the glorious presence of God. Why do we lack God's presence? Instead of thinking of sin as missing the mark, a better understanding of sin is stepping off the path or veering off the road. God has marked a clear path for us, but we have wandered away from it. Everything on God's path leads to life, and everything off this path leads to death. Sin, therefore, is to walk on the path that leads to death. So let's rewrite the recipe to look like this. One part, God's glorious presence, glory of God. One part, to be lacking, fall short. One part, wandered off the path, sin. These three ingredients create a different meal. All have wandered off God's path of life and now lack God's glorious presence. The accent is now on us wandering away from God, not God rejecting us for our failure. The primary assumption now is that God has created a way, a path, a law, for God and humanity to dwell together in life. And while God desires for humanity to live with God, this is the overlapping of heaven and earth, right now sin prevents that from happening. Heaven and earth have been torn apart. If God longs for us to dwell in His presence and has made a way for us to do this, it becomes much easier to believe God is a God of love. This way of reading Romans chapter 3, verse 23, while different from what we're used to, helps us see that though we have wandered away from God, God still longs for us to dwell in His presence and pursue His purposes. Our goal throughout is to show that Romans chapter 3, verse 23, and all of Scripture, understand salvation in just this way, and that returning to this path of life returns us not only to God's glorious presence, but also to the joy of being with the God who has always wanted to be with us. Why this book? We wrote this book for two reasons. First, you belong in God's presence, God with us. Second, you have a place within God's purposes, God through us. In other words, God is always glad to be with you and wants nothing more than to draw you closer into His family. And from this place, God invites you into the family business, the business of blessing the world. We will see that both of these produce joy in us, a joy matched only by God's joy in us. We would like to take you on a journey from the beginning to the end of God's work with humanity, from Genesis to Revelation. We'll show you how God continually demonstrates a desire to be with His people, no matter what we do, and we'll highlight the ways God always invites people to join Him in His unfolding plan to spread new and unending life throughout the entire world. Overview. In the chapters to come, we'll explore the story of God with us and through us in four parts: God's idols in creation, God's house in Israel, God's body in Jesus Christ, and God's movement in and through the church. For those who like all the details, each part has four chapters. The first looks at the big picture of God's work with humanity. The second unfolds how humanity belongs in God's presence, God with us, while the third explores how humanity is gathered up into God's purposes for the world, God through us. And the last chapter in each part focuses on a defining failure of humanity to live in God's presence and for God's purposes. At the end of each chapter, you'll find 1. A practice to help you build joy and connection with God. 2. A reflection question to help you personalize what you've heard in the chapter. 3. A song whose lyrics speak to the theme of the chapter. And 4. An image to help trace the themes of God's presence and purpose through the biblical narrative. Chapter 1. What is that smell? On a trip to France during college, I was walking through a historic garden in Paris with my older sister. Rounding one of the reflecting pools, we both caught a familiar scent and stopped dead in our tracks. Grandpa and Grandma's backyard in Washington. Joy swept over us. We had no idea what the smell was or where it was coming from. But in a split second, we were transported from a thriving metropolitan city in Europe to a quiet backyard in the northwestern corner of the United States, all by a smell. We searched the gardens and discovered juniper bushes covered in bright red berries. We bent over and buried our noses in the bushes and began to reminisce about our summers in Washington State, visiting our grandparents. Our bodies were in France, but our minds and our memories were running barefoot through the mowed grass of a small-town backyard where we would salt slugs and lay pennies on the railroad tracks while our grandpa smoked salmon strung up on smoldering cedar planks. That smell of juniper stirred up memories so sharp and clear that we not only remembered the slugs and the pennies, but also the feeling of youthful innocence when we were surrounded by people who loved us and watched over us with great delight as we reveled in the simple pleasures of childhood. We hadn't been there for more than 10 years, and it was over 5,000 miles away, but that smell transported us from Paris to Linden, Washington. We were filled with the joy at the memory of being loved in such a lovely place, surrounded by people who were always glad to be with us. Our grandparents delighted in our presence, celebrated our accomplishments, prayed for us daily, played games with us, baked cookies with us, and were always interested in what we were up to. When we were with our grandparents, we were sure we were loved because of the delight they took in being with us. And in response, we experienced the joy that came from being with people who were glad to be with us. This delight, this joy, is what home is all about. It's what we're all looking for, and it's what many of us have never experienced. We're looking for a place to live in the presence of joy, and from that place, to venture out and contribute to the world, and it's never too late to come home to joy. This book is about the return home, the return to joy. The joy of creation. Let's start with things at their best. At the beginning, all of creation is caught up in the joy of belonging in God's presence. Because God delights in everything He has made, creation responds with joy. The Psalms regularly declare as much. The pastures of the wilderness overflow. The hills gird themselves with joy. The meadows clothe themselves with flocks. The valleys deck themselves with grain. They shout and sing together for joy. Psalm 65, verses 12 and 13. Let the heavens be glad, and let the earth rejoice. Let the sea roar, and all that fills it. Psalm 96, verse 11. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Break forth into joyous song and sing praises. Psalm 98, verse 4. As the heavens and earth are filled with God's glorious presence, so too the heavens and earth are full of joy and praise. Joy is the very foundation of reality. Joy is where life began and where life is headed. Creation begins with the joyful communion of God with humanity, the beginning of the book of Genesis. And at the end of all things, God and humanity will dwell together again in great joy. The end of the book of Revelation. Joy is the background music to our lives. It's the soundtrack. It's always there. We just don't always know how to access it. But when we do, joy changes everything. Joy brings us home to the place God made for us. Joy in the brain. Joy is woven into the fabric of creation, and it's also wired into our brains. To understand the song of joy as it plays throughout creation, we need to understand a few things about how the brain works and how the capacity, even the necessity, for joy is built into us neurologically. Humans are born with a fundamental desire to connect with other people. We desire to be wanted, to be delighted in, to be seen and known. We all need the presence of another person. We all crave, neurologically, the experience of joy. In fact, joy can be defined as the experience of being with someone who you feel connected to, someone who is glad to be with you. This will be our definition of joy throughout this book. Tragically, many of us are born into environments that are far from joyful. Ideally, when a baby is born into a healthy family, she is received with gladness. Her parents look on her with delight, and the baby responds with joy. The baby is wanted, is loved. Her parents will make sure she has enough to eat, keep her warm and dry, cuddle her, sing to her, hold her and play with her. All along, the baby's brain is awash in positive neurological activity, activating parts of the brain especially wired to trigger joy in response to other people. Every time the baby feels connected to someone who loves her, she grows stronger in her identity through the experience of joy. By the time she is 3 months old, she will have images of her delighted caregiver's face firmly planted in her brain. These wordless images become the foundation for her identity. When she becomes distressed, her caregiver is there, even if just as a memory. From comfort to a difficult situation, and back to comfort, the baby's neural pathways are learning how to return to the joy of connection amid distress. This process can be called returning to joy. During this early journey from distress and back to joy, the baby is internalizing some important things. Even in her pre-verbal state, the tiny child knows that someone sees her, hears her crying, and understands what she is experiencing. Someone is glad to be with her and does whatever is needed to alleviate her distress, changing her diaper, feeding her, cuddling her, or rocking her to sleep. This empathy and attention are referred to as attunement. Over time, this process creates neural pathways capable of carrying the child out of pain and returning her to joy. As this happens over and over again, the child internalizes that she is seen, heard, and understood. Eventually, even when her caregiver is not present, she can return to joy just by thinking of and remembering being loved. Exploring from joy. Children and then adults with a firm foundation of joy also have the capacity to make positive contributions in the world. It starts with play and exploration. When a child has a firm foundation of joy, then little by little, the child will adventure further and further into the world, even if it is just a new toy or the next room over. The bumps and bruises of exploration are overcome by being able to return to joy, either through the physical presence or the memory of a safe person. A child with a firm foundation of joy assumes the world is a fundamentally safe place, even if it is punctured by occasional pain or distress. As the child grows into adulthood, their exploration and play turn into the courage and creativity to contribute to the world in a positive way. Our brains are wired for joy. They are conditioned for connection. Relational experiences, joy and shame. Joy is fundamentally a relational experience. Joy requires other people. You can't experience joy without another person present or without at least thinking about another person. Sadly, many of us don't get a joyful start to life. For some of us, our caretakers were absent or distracted. We grew up in a stressful or dangerous environment or in a home or neighborhood where basic necessities were absent. We grew up learning that no one was there to hear us, no one sees what we need, and no one will act on our behalf. Or worse, we learn that the people who are supposed to care for us actually despise us. This brings us to shame, the shadow side of joy. Shame is the experience of being with someone who is not glad to be with us. Shame is feeling disconnected from someone who isn't glad to be with us. Sometimes we feel shame because we sin, And as a result, we break our relationships with others and so experience disconnection. But sometimes the disconnection is not our fault. We experience abuse, neglect, intense anger, and unearned disgust from others. In these situations, we still experience a disconnection, even if the disconnection is not a result of our own sin. Although shame is often connected to our sin, shame can also be experienced because of someone else's sin coming at us. Without healthy and loving relationships, it is difficult to experience joy and easy to experience shame. Many of us never had these healthy relationships, and many of us don't have much joy in our lives. We carry loads of shame instead. Often our attempts to manage shame lead us into deeper sin and further away from joyful relationships. But that doesn't change the fact that we are driven by the desire to be in the presence of someone who is glad to be with us, the desire to be wanted, to be connected. And we search for these connections everywhere we go. When we don't find them in relationships, we look for them in things, in chocolate, wine, distractions, and addictions. But these aren't capable of building joy. They are false substitutes. And our world is saturated with the smell of false joy, fake belonging, and artificial connection. The joy of creation and our certainty of belonging with God are drowned out by the stench of sin and shame. Identity and joy. Let's get back to the brain for a moment. Joy is experienced in the same part of the brain where our sense of identity is built. When someone has a strong foundation of joy, he knows who he is. He is the same person when he is angry, sad, afraid, or glad. His emotions do not change his understanding of himself or the way others experience him. He has a steady sense of self and does not need to pretend to be someone he's not. Because he feels safe and strong, he can be himself. Conversely, someone who does not have a strong foundation of joy has a fragile identity. It will seem like he changes into a different person when he is overwhelmed by negative emotions. The person you thought you knew will disappear, and someone else seems to take his place, even if for just a moment. He will lose himself in these emotions, and you'll wonder how he can be capable of such different kinds of behaviors. Joy is the foundation of our identity and our resilience. Our neural pathways are wired as a result of our early experiences of joy. Without a strong foundation of joy, we struggle for identity and are crippled by shame. It's no wonder Scripture declares, "The joy of the Lord is my strength." Nehemiah chapter 8, verse 10. The good news is that our brains are changeable. It's never too late to connect with someone who is glad to be with you and to experience the joy of that connection. When this happens, new neural pathways are formed. Your brain can be literally transformed by the renewing of your minds. Romans chapter 12, verse 2. Presence and purpose. Springing from a foundation of joy is the capacity for creative contribution. The joyful presence of one person gives us the ability to pursue creative work on behalf of other people, passing along both joy and love. If we feel we belong, then we will be free to bless others. Presence and purpose. Connection and contribution. Belonging and blessing. These are the fundamental notes of joy that will sound throughout this book. Because everything already belongs in God's presence, joy is the natural state of all things. When we listen closely, the sound underneath everything that exists is the song of joy. Joy is the song sung in response to God's presence, the one who is glad to be with us and with all of His creation. Practice. Finding your joy place. Think back over your life and try to remember a place where you felt safe and at peace, a time when you felt relaxed and okay. It could be an outdoor place, like on a beach or sitting in a tree. Maybe it's an indoor place, like a quiet reading chair or a kitchen table. Close your eyes and remember this place as completely as you can. Imagine yourself being there, noticing the sights, sounds, feels, smells, tastes. Notice what it feels like in your body to be there. Spend a minute enjoying this place, using your imagination. Notice what it feels like to be safe and at peace. Then take some time to thank God for this place, no matter how small or normal it might seem. Reflection. Remember the last time you were with someone who was glad to be with you. How did this person greet you? How could you tell that they were glad to be with you? What was it like to be together? This is what joy feels like. Song. Listen to Joy by Rend Collective. Will you open yourself again to the hope of joy? Creation is a place of joy, where God is glad to be with us.
Part 1. God's Idols. Chapter 2. Where is Home? About a month away from our first son's due date, we were preparing to move into the church parsonage. On a Sunday evening in late June, we walked around the empty house, spackling holes, taping off ceilings and floorboards, and making plans to paint walls. In the morning, we would open the paint cans and get started. But God had other plans. A little after midnight, we were on our way to the hospital instead. Soren was born the next morning, 4 weeks early. Nothing in our old apartment was packed. Nothing in the new house was ready. And now we had a new baby to look after. With no home to go to, Cyd and baby Soren headed to a hotel. Right at the beginning of our new life as a family, we were temporarily homeless. It was totally disorienting. This experience matched the disorientation we would feel 15 years later. During the summer of 2018, we were fully immersed in our life as a family, now with two boys. But God changed everything again. After a six-week whirlwind, we discerned with friends and the Holy Spirit that God was moving us from Chicago to Grand Rapids, Michigan. With the help of both our old and new communities, we were able to buy a house in Grand Rapids. As part of the sale, we agreed to allow the seller to stay in the house for 30 days after closing. So when we moved on Labor Day weekend to begin work at our new church, our house wasn't ready for us. Fortunately, a friend of a friend offered to let us stay in his cottage on Lake Michigan. The time in the cottage started off great, enjoying the beach, kayaking, gorgeous sunsets, stunning moonrises. But after 2 weeks, we were getting anxious to move into our own house. We had left a home we'd lived in for 15 years and a church we'd attended for 17. We felt uprooted, disoriented, and disconnected. We wanted to be home. We longed for a place where we could set a table for new friends and neighbors. Hard to come by. We all live in a transitive world. People transfer to new cities for their jobs, upgrade to bigger homes, downsize to smaller apartments, or get new roommates. The days of growing up in a single home with your grandparents living just down the street have faded. These days, a sense of home is hard to come by. Many of us go about our days living in places we know are temporary, on our way to something else. We're more disconnected from our families than at any other time in human history, and more on the move. We are more virtual and less face-to-face. it's harder and harder to find places of belonging and connection than ever before. We long for a place where we feel rooted, grounded, at home. The good news is that we always have a home with God. In fact, all of creation is the house God built to make a home for His family. And God always intended to move in, to live with His family. God wanted to build a place that would become the foundation for joy, the place where humanity would know security in being known and loved by God, and from this place to venture out and contribute to blessing God's creation. Reading backward. The idea that the heavens and earth are God's home is woven into the story of creation found in Genesis chapters 1 through 3. Sometimes when people are learning to draw, they are asked to sketch familiar objects upside down and told to focus on the spaces between things. The idea is to get past the normal expectations and see something new, something that has always been there. The story of creation may be so familiar to you that you haven't read it recently, but we want to urge you to look again, to approach this story from a different angle and see what you may have missed. While it would be difficult to read Genesis chapters 1 through 3 upside down, we are going to read it backward. We'll see how everything was made as a home for God to live in, a home where joy would spring forth from the relationship between God, the good and loving Father, and His children. Not just a garden. If you were to go to work today and you found the place surrounded by Secret Service, what would you think? Most people would assume the President of the United States was somewhere nearby. Why? Because the main job of the Secret Service is to protect the President. They are his security guards. Wherever the Secret Service is, you can bet the President is nearby. When we look at Genesis chapter 3, verse 24, we find the exact same thing. God's security guards. Let's look at the whole verse. God drove out the man. And at the east of the Garden of Eden He placed the cherubim and a sword flaming and turning to guard the way to the tree of life. God placed a specific kind of angel, cherubim, at the entrance of the garden to guard the way back in. Why is this significant? Cherubim are especially associated with God's presence. They are God's Secret Service agents. Whenever we find cherubim in the Bible, God is nearby.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.